G'day, I'm Glenn Morris from the Smart Energy Lab. And yesterday we installed the Nation Energie sodium ion battery. Now, sodium ion sounds a bit like lithium ion. In fact, it's very similar in terms of the construction of the cells. But one big difference is it doesn't have that nasty copper. When I say nasty copper, it adds expense, but also it's one of the shortcomings of a lithium ion battery is the copper anode, when you over discharge a lithium ion battery, starts to dissolve into the electrolyte. And that's when the trouble starts. So, sodium ion, it's a relatively new tech in my experience. It's the first time I've ever seen one. We had the team here yesterday from Nation Energie installing an R&D version of the sodium ion battery. The 11.5 kilowatt hour, 9.45 kilowatt hour usable battery pack. Now, this will become probably pretty shortly available as a finished product. This is the R&D version, so you can see all the BMS boards, etc., on the fronts of the cells. But the finished version will be a more conventional design, probably the same sort of capacity. So why am I excited by sodium ion? Well, for a start, there's always been a bit of concern about lithium, really, in terms of its resource scarcity. There's only a handful of lithium mines around the world, so it is a scarce resource. Sodium, by contrast, is one of the fourth or fifth most common elements on the planet. Basically, you can get sodium from lots of sources, including probably seawater. Now, we're not talking a saltwater battery here. I've heard a few people confused by the term sodium ion. Basically, it's the same basic principles as a lithium ferrophosphate battery. You have an anode and a cathode, you have an electrolyte, you've got sodium as the active material in the cell, but it has a different voltage characteristic, quite different to lithium ion batteries. One of the, you could say useful or sometimes challenging characteristics of sodium ion is that as the state of charge diminishes, so does the voltage. But the clever people at Nation Energie and their suppliers have come up with a solution, which is basically a DC-DC converter that at a cell level optimizes the cell voltage for the pack voltage. And therefore, it doesn't really matter how much the cell voltage drops as it discharges, it will still produce the same output from the BMS. Clever idea. On top of that, you've also got, with that gradient of capacity of voltage, a very predictable way of calculating state of charge, as opposed to a very flat discharge characteristic for a lithium-ion battery. Anyway, I was excited to have it installed here at the lab, and it's actually running the equipment in my studio right now. So if the lights are on, it must be working. So let's have a look at how the installation process went. And I also interviewed Thomas and Noel, who were involved in the installation of this unit. Over to you guys. G'day, Tom. So you're from Nation Energie.
Nation Energie, correct.
Now, why the spelling Nation with a plus in the middle?
Very good question, Glenn. Our clever designers came up with that. So Nation is Na for sodium plus ION. So it's a sodium ion chemistry. And we came up with Nation Energie as our trademark.
Now, in the background, we can see the team working. We've got Noel and Anne here installing a R&D unit for me here at the lab to have a play with.
Correct.
Why did you choose sodium ion as a chemistry?
Good question. So we did a lot of work looking around for alternative chemistry to lithium ion for a whole lot of reasons. Number one, sustainability. Number two, cost. Number three, performance. Sodium ion is a genuine alternative to LFP in particular. And we found Faradion in the UK, who are the world leaders in sodium ion. And we've joined a joint venture with them between a group in Melbourne called ICM Investments and Faradion in the UK, and we've come together to create Nation Energie to commercialise and bring to market the world-leading sodium ion technology.
Wow. So this unit here kind of looks like a residential unit, but you're actually going to be bringing out a different form factor.
Correct, correct. So the demonstration unit is very much over-engineered to make sure that the chemistry works. And the purpose of the install here today and the purpose of all the installs we're doing with our demonstration units or R&D units is to really prove to the market and prove to the world that sodium ion is a ready technology. It's not just on the lab, it's here, it's real life. You can buy these production units off the shelf and we're ready to go. The actual units that we will bring to market in a commercial sense will be a 19-inch rack mount, 48 volt, and then with a higher voltage, and then probably a residential BESS to come in a couple of years' time.
Now, people often ask, certainly when it comes to lithium, what's the, you know, the security of supply? You know, lithium, people worry there's only about a handful of mines around the world. How are we for sodium mines?
Is that a Dorothy Dixer? Because sodium is obviously abundant. I think it's fourth or third most abundant chemical in the earth. So we have no problem finding sodium. Of course, it's not just sodium in there, but we have no copper, no lithium, no cobalt in our technology.
So it's starting to sound a bit like table salt in terms of the chemistry.
Well, it's not sodium chloride, it's the sodium bit of sodium chloride.
Right, yep. Right, so sodium ion as a chemistry has some other features. Now, you mentioned sustainability. What do you mean by that?
So sustainability in that it's not using any toxic materials, but also the CO2 produced over the lifetime of a sodium ion battery versus even an LFP battery is about one third of the CO2 emissions over its lifetime. So there's a real advantage in sodium ion from a sustainability perspective.
Right. And in terms of recycling, is it difficult to repurpose?
It's exactly the same as a lithium ion, except we don't have all the expensive toxic metals in there at the end of the day, like lithium.
So there's always a bit of a concern with lithium batteries in terms of thermal runaway. Is that an issue for sodium ion?
It's not really an issue. Of course, at, you know, extreme temperatures, stuff will happen, but our electrolyte is up to 300 degrees Celsius or higher.
So, Tom, you mentioned that one of the three characteristics of the battery was cost. What do you mean? Expensive or cheap?
So it's cheaper. So we can quantify that very easily by doing an analysis of the bill of materials. At full production capacity, which will happen, I should say, with our manufacturing partner who actually own Faradin, is a company called Reliance Industries, and they're putting up a manufacturing plant in India to produce cathode and produce cells, and all our analysis says that we should be 30% cheaper than LFP at scale.
So, Noel, welcome to Australia.
Thanks, Ben.
So, Noel, what's been your involvement with the Faradin battery?
Well, going back in history, I'm one of the earliest employees for the company. I've been there pretty much since day one. Now I'm senior engineer at Faradin, so most of these things have come across my desk as a drawing file and then eventually ended up being here on
right.
The other side of the planet.
So this R&D unit, you've been involved in actually building this whole unit?
Yep.
You know, every nut and bolt.
Every single nut and bolt, repeatedly.
Well, let me ask the first obvious question. What's all the lights about?
The lights. So it's more information for us at the moment. It's telling us that each board is operating the way it wants. It's quite a different pack architecture. So it's an active BMS, and effectively every cell is isolated from the next. So each board needs to operate for the pack to operate itself.
So each of those boards is a pack of cells, which have been controlled by the board, which does what?
Effectively, it's a DC-DC converter. It's a very complicated DC-DC converter, but it's changing the voltage from the cells to an output voltage that we can control using CAN messages to and from it.
So Noel, the cell packs here, do you want to just point to them so we know what we're talking about?
Yeah, inside this box.
Okay, so those rectangles though, behind the control boards, what do they contain?
Inside each one, there's a series of pouch cells. In this case, there's two banks, each is welded in parallel. So we have a stack of cells here and a stack of cells here. If you can see these two cables here, you have a positive and a negative. They go to each of these electronics boards independently. And what it does is it takes the voltage and the energy from the cell, whatever voltage the cell happens to be at, it then converts that to a 6-volt output voltage. So we control the current coming from the cells, and then we control the pack voltage actively.
So the cell voltage can be wildly different between cell packs, but the control boards bring them all together onto the same DC bus.
Exactly.
Oh, that's very clever. Now, you were telling me that the voltage characteristic with respect to state of charge is quite different from a lithium battery.
Yes, yeah. A normal lithium battery will have a relatively flat voltage profile between its different state of charge. Sodium ion has a particularly slanty voltage profile. There's an advantage for us in many ways. Things like state of charge estimation is very easy to do. For this system, we decided to use an active BMS that can manage a wider voltage window, and we can play with it a little bit more.
So I believe these cells can go down to 0 volts without harm.
Yes, they can. Yeah, they like being at zero.
They like being at zero. All right. It's one of the problems I have with storing lithium ion batteries is eventually they go a bit too low, and then it's really hard to resuscitate them.
Yeah, for most lithium chemistries, when you go low enough, there's copper dissolution into the electrolyte, and that is bad news for the cells themselves. With sodium ion cells, we don't need to use copper. So we can pull the cells all the way down to 0 volts. In fact, that's how we transport these. The cells are physically shorted and there's no electrical energy in the cells as they're transported.
Yeah, so in terms of transport, they're a very safe battery transport because you can transport them with zero state of charge.
Yes, yeah. So the transport regulations for getting them around the world it drops the category that it's in. So it becomes much simpler than transporting, for example, LFP.
Now, up the top here, you've got, what do we call this?
These are my electronics bays.
Yep.
So the power electronics and the master controllers for all these different boards is all held in here. It has things like fuses, contactors, and any CAN processing parts that we have in there.
Right. Now, the circuit breakers here are a bit unusual. They move.
Yes, they're remote actuated units, is what they're called. So rather than being a normal circuit breaker, which you flick on and off yourself, these guys wait for a signal from the BMS. So the pack has to be entirely happy before it will start to close them and send itself into a pre-charge.
Oh, right. So it does its own pre-charge with a single connection to the PCE. To
exactly.
The inverter. Yep. All right. So to turn these on and off, really just that little circular green light.
Yep.
That turns on the electronics, which then control the circuit breakers in parallel.
Exactly.
Wow. That's a pretty impressive DC connector there.
Yes.
Now, when the production units come out, what similarities will we see with what we're looking here with the R&D unit?
The cells will be very similar. They're the parts you can't see.
Yep.
So the chemistry won't fundamentally change. The electronics will change quite a lot, just because the sheer amount of electronics we have in this. And the safety systems that we have in here, you mentioned the REUs and that, we will do something similar, but not the same way.
And the form factor, will it still be a vertical box like this?
No, it's going to be a 19-inch rack. Right. That's our first product that we're aiming for.
What's the kilowatt hour capacity of this unit?
Just under 10, it's 9.5 kilowatt hours.
Right, and with the rack mounted units?
Will be between 3 and 4, depending on what arrangement we have in it. So we have a few different arrangements.
What sort of RU spacing will that be?
4.
4 RU. Yeah. And you can get 3 to 4 kilowatt hours per 4 RU.
Yep.
At nominal 48 volt.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah. Now, one of the interesting characteristics about this battery is it does go to 0 volts. So I guess there's not every inverter likes that.
Yeah.
What are you working with at the moment?
So we have a manual workaround to pull it to 0 volts for shipping and to resume it. For the rack mount, that will be automated.
Right. So you don't have to use an inverter like we're using the Victron Multiplus if you don't take it to 0 volts. So if you manage it at a 10% state of charge or something, then regular inverters will work with it.
Yes, totally. Yeah. We have a can feed that comes out and we have a power feed that comes out. It doesn't matter what inverter it's connected to. We can change the CAN messages if that's what we need to do. But it'll work with any inverter that currently exists.
Great. Well, thanks, Noel, for coming out and installing this amazing piece of kit.
Great. Thanks for having us, Glenn.
Okay.